Hey, 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 and welcome to another episode of the Crew Podcast.
Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now. Where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the wind that blows from the north and south and east. Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now.
At Wings of Transformation Publishing, we are committed to helping our authors reach their goals and pursue their dreams of becoming published authors. We work closely with each author to ensure a successful publishing experience, and we are dedicated to helping them.
Podcast show with your host Emma Thomas. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever shall believe shall not perish but have everlasting life.
And I am your host of Inspirational Moments with Prophetess T, Minister Alma Thomas. So if you're here for the first time, like, subscribe, and comment. If you're coming back, welcome, welcome, welcome. I hope you had a wonderful Wednesday. And like every day week, we're starting with a quote. And this week's quote comes from the Bible, 2 Samuel 7, 14 to 15. I will be a father to him, and he'll be a son to me. When he does wrong, I'll discipline him in the usual ways, the pitfalls and obstacles of this mortal life, but I'll never remove my graciousness from him. Once again, that is from 2 Samuel 7, 14 and 15. And before we do anything, we like to go to the throne of grace, because the word says that whatever you do, do it in Jesus' name. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, in the precious, matchless name of your Son, Jesus, we come to you tonight, God. We put this program into your hands, God. Let it be edifying to the body of Christ so that we can not only live in the church, but outside of the church. God bless everybody who is listening on tonight. You know the things that they have need of, God. Grant them those things that they have need of. We don't even know how to pray as we ought, but Jesus works intercessory for us tonight. We give you the glory, we give you the power, and we give you the honor in Jesus' name. On tonight, we are talking about fatherhood and father engagement that a lot of fathers think that if they just pay their child support, that that is sufficient. But research has shown that it is more important for a father to be in their child's life than just to donate money, that a child needs their father in their life. I was, I went to an in-service training a couple of years ago, and I found out that I was a little biased, that I would concentrate on the mothers in my classroom, but I would not do anything to encourage the fathers, because I grew up in a fatherless home. My son had male role models, but his father passed away when he was very young. So I found out that because I was so used to doing everything on my own and being a single mother, that I didn't make the fathers feel like they were welcome in my classroom. And then I began to change that and would do things to encourage the fathers to come into the classroom and spend time with their children. Because a lot of the fathers would think that if they go to work and they're providing for their families, that that is enough. But we found out doing research that children that fathers are in their life are less likely to get in trouble, less likely to join gangs, less likely to have a teenage pregnancy, because boys need their fathers to show them how to be a man, how to love a woman. Girls need their father to show them how a man is supposed to treat a woman. And when a father has been a good role model for his children, most of the time, a girl looks for in a man the same things that she received from her father. And so there are many ways, because I spent 32 years teaching Head Start, I am familiar with the 3 to 5 year old age group. And we used to do a lot of activities to get the fathers to come in. And sometimes you have to adjust your schedule to work in fathers. Like sometimes we would have things in the morning before they went to work. And I would tell them, you don't have to stay all day. Just show up for a few minutes, help serve breakfast, read a book to the child, to the children. And it doesn't, you can still go to work. Sometimes we would do things after school that when the fathers got off, they can attend. And I'm very, very excited right now that my guest is here, and he's in the stead of Chaplain Anthony James. How are you doing?
Man, Chaplain, I'm blessed. James. I'm blessed. How you doing, Alma? It's always a blessing. You know what I mean? You're a soldier. You definitely are doing what God is calling you to do. So I'm honored to be here tonight to share this platform with you tonight.
And I am honored to have you on this platform. So can you tell us a little bit about you? At the end of the show, I'm going to allow you to talk about your books and how people can reach you. But right now, can you tell us a little bit about Chaplain James?
Chaplain James. Well, you know, I'm originally from New York. I relocated to North Carolina 12 years ago. It's been long. It's 12 years went so fast, though. And so, you know, I just listening to you talk about the father, the fatherless homes, and with all that stuff. And you can see, I see Sid got my shirt on, Empowered Fathers. You know what I mean? I'm an empowered father today. And once upon a time, you know, I had the same struggles dealing with, because I got three children by three different women. So that was, I know what you're talking about, because I came to the Head Start to deal with my children, even when you was working there. You know what I mean? So I can attest to that. And yeah, this journey has been, for me, being a father, man, is very important. It's detrimental to the point where it's now, if you see these younger teenagers now growing up without a father in the home, man, it's not a good situation. So I've been on this journey trying to connect with different men that's dealt with the same situations I've dealt with, as far as leaving the home, leaving the children in the situation, and it's a struggle. And so my ministry, you know, God has been blessing me to do this ministry in the prisons, outside the prisons. I have a mentorship program that I deal with just men, you know, coming out, men that ain't never been to prison that still deal with, you know, being fatherless to their kids in some sense. You know, and so that's what's been going on in my life. And my ministry, God is definitely just, it's a crazy ministry to the point of it's hard. It's hard because men, we're very tough. We're very hard-headed. We're very stubborn in areas. And so to pull men together, to get them to realize that the mistakes they made based on, you know, now it's hard to get them. So that's been a real, real challenge for me, but I'm for the challenge.
Amen. Looking back on your career, talk about something that you regret.
I regret my career. I regret not, I'm going to say, you know, just getting it, because I had a father in my life. I had a father. I was brought up in a two-family home. My dad stayed with my mom for 60 years. You know what I mean? So I had that experience. So, but I'm not my dad. One thing that me and my dad, we were present in the household because he stayed there, but we didn't have any connection. And so that I regretted leaving the nest earlier than I was supposed to. Because once I left the nest, my father was like, if you leave, you ain't coming back here. And once I did that, my life just spiraled out of control. You know what I mean? Because I didn't have that male figure that really loved me, because the streets ain't love me. The streets showed a false type of love. So I regret leaving my household at an age where I didn't understand anything at the age of 14. I left, came back. Then other stuff started happening. That's the regret that I can look back on and say, man, that was my greatest regret, leaving the house early.
What was your proudest moment as a father?
My proudest moment, you know, when they was born. When they was born, you know, because I didn't know what being a father was until even in all through the pregnancies or whatever. But at the end of the day, once that child came, I was just proud. Like, wow, I'm going to be a dad. I'm going to be a father. Like, you know, so that was one of my proudest moments of being a father.
What was your hardest moment as being a father?
Being responsible because I didn't understand. I saw my dad do it, but I'm not my dad. So, because when trial and error came, he still stood the test of time. I ran. So, you know, hardest is being a father, being a person that cared about my child, my children, and helping, matter of fact, trying to nurture. The woman's the nurturer, I'm the head. So trying to be the head, man, if you don't know what that consists of, you better ask somebody, you know what I mean? And ask somebody.
So yeah. You talked about your father being in a home and that he was there, but y'all didn't really communicate. So how would you like to be like your father, and what part of you is different from your father?
Well, the part of me that was different from my dad, because there was seven of us, okay? So he was like, listen, he didn't really communicate much. He had to make ends meet. So at the end of the day, he was tough, man, rounded. You know, he played with us at times, but for the most part, you know, for instance, like cut the grass. We had chores back then. So at the end of the day, I had to cut the grass, but I didn't do it right. So I used to get a beating for not doing it right. And what I did different than my dad did with me, instead of telling my children, I showed my children. You know what I mean? Because it's a big difference. When you tell somebody to do so, that's just like nobody never got on Google and you tell them to Google this. They may be able to cut Google on, but do they understand what Google really consists of? You know what I mean? And so I didn't understand, because when I did the grass, I made the lines a little crooked. My dad didn't like that. So in my head, I was saying, man, why don't this dude show me? If he showed me, I'll probably do a better job. So through that trial and error, what I've learned from that, to show my kids better than just telling them, because they don't understand. So that was the difference.
So what lessons do you hope to pass on to your children?
Well, I want to pass on, first of all, building a relationship with God. That's first and foremost. I want them to learn that from me. I want to pass that on as a legacy, not just money. You know what I mean? Inheritance is who you become, not what you get. So my legacy, I want to leave my children to honor God is they honor themselves and then honor their parents as well. I want them to honor their parents, you know, because this generation now, there's no honor because they were raised a certain kind of way. And I'm glad I was raised that way. So I would love to leave that with my children, to really tap into the spirit of God as they know, you know, get to know who God is. It's a journey. So that's what I would love to leave.
What relationships do you think have helped you keep your friendships and romantic relationships strong, especially your marriage now?
Well, I mean, to be honest with you, I can't really attest to a person. I can attest to God. The Spirit of God is what helped me. Because I've been through two divorces. This is my third marriage, so I really didn't. Back then, it was taboo to talk to people. It was taboo for somebody to get in your business. You didn't want nobody in your business. And so I had to lean close to God to help me understand what love is really about, because I didn't know. I didn't understand it. I thought love was having sex and, you know, going out on a date. And I thought it was just about that. You know what I mean? Intimacy is way deeper than that. So I had to learn from God to really love myself first before I can love any other woman, you know what I mean?
Right. If you could change one thing about your fatherhood, what would it be?
Well, I would be more patient. I would be more patient, like I'm getting now. Because it's a thing. When you get older, you know, things start changing a little bit. You know what I mean? You start seeing a little differently. But in my younger years married and being a father, you know, I would pay attention more being responsible in certain areas where I missed. You know what I mean? Where I could have missed that. You know, I could have been a little better. You know, I would pay attention to that. Just being more patient and aware, you know.
What qualities do you most value in yourself?
Well, I'm humble. You know, I'm God-fearing. I love. I understand what love is. That's the qualities. And I'm understanding. I used to hate that. I said, Lord, you put understanding. Why do you want me to understand everything? You understand? So I understand that that's very valuable to understand. And we know in Proverbs 4:7, it says, in all thy getting, get understanding. Because we go through life with these different ideologies and methodologies, but we don't understand. And that's when you get hurt or you hurt someone else through a lack of understanding. So understanding is really, really what's, that's my go-to, trying to understand what my walk is about, you know?
Do you think then, this is not a question that I wrote down, but do you think now that a lot of women don't understand how important a father relationship is to their children? Like, when you break up with me, now you can't see your kids anymore. Mm-hmm. And a lot of fathers, there are some fathers that hang in there and fight, but there's a lot of fathers just walk away because they don't want to go through that drama. So you think that there's a lot of women who use their children as a pawn?
For sure. For sure. That's part of the problem. That's part of the problem. It's not all the man. You know what I mean? Because it's like, you know, I have a program called Boys Becoming Men. And it's a lot of boys and men bodies that they don't really understand. But the ones that do try to stay there with their children, the conflict with the mother and the father, the woman does use the kids for pawns because that's her strength. Because she knows physicality, she can't beat a man. Or the only way to get to a man's heart is his children. So of course, that's huge right now. And I hear a lot of women speaking out against it, but once the damage is done, it's like a woman's scorn. They said hell has no fury. You know what I mean? Once that woman is upset with you, done with you like that, you just got to figure it out the best way you can. And I thank God that because of my upbringing, because of God, you know, I had a lot of that drama in my life, but I stayed the course with my children because I love my children. Because one thing I did learn, my dad didn't leave me. He didn't care what my mom dealt with. You know what I'm saying? He brushed it off, but he made sure he stayed there and he represented. And so I try to follow that, you know. But yeah, of course, the women, they need some help too in that area, you know, because it's not about just the woman. You didn't just lay down and have that baby by yourself. You understand? That man was very present at that time, you know? So, yeah.
Yeah, that's true. That I even, as a woman, I see that. And that a lot of times it's like, oh, if he's not paying child support or right, he's not giving me what I want, or right, don't have another girlfriend, then, oh, I don't want that be around. You don't even know her. She hasn't done anything to harm your child. But just because he's with someone else, you have a very negative attitude. So I think that women need to be educated, right, that your children need their father. Like, a lot of times we'll say, oh, I don't need no man. My son don't need no father. But I was a single parent, and I had to, before my son passed away, I had to give him male role models because I couldn't teach him how to be a man. I couldn't know how a man feels, what a man is going through. He needed other men to teach him that.
Right.
And, you know, because his father passed away, we had to find men in the community like you that, you know, go out, just not for your own child, but right, for other children to see that positive male role model in their life. A lot of men don't know how to be men because they didn't have any men in their lives. And we as women tried to substitute, but a woman can't, no matter how you argue, when you look at it, a woman cannot teach a man how to be a man.
Right.
So are there things you wish you had done differently as a father?
Yes. Yeah, of course. I mean, we all think back and to see the mistakes or the decisions that we made to now. You're a little older, you're a little bit more disciplined, and you're like, wow, man, if I'd have did this a little bit differently. And yeah, you know, one of the things I, you know, wish I would have done was to not beat myself up so hard. You know, not put so much pressure, because I had to learn. You know what I mean? This is not, doesn't come with a script or a book, or, you know, you don't get answers, but you got to go through the process of learning and growing, because you have to get to know the children. The children has to get to know you, not just respect you, but know you. You know what I mean? That you, that they know that you, you know, I, what I stood for. And I did pretty good at it, but at the same token, you know, just could have been more, a little bit more assertive. You know, I was always, you know, I was kind of, you know, I was really, it was a lot. It was a lot. Raising children is not a game. You know, most men, you know, they take flight because the responsibility. But once I started understanding that God, he's, those are his children. I had to understand, I had to get it right, because they didn't ask to be born into this world. So that helped me kick into another situation to say, yo, you know what? I got to learn this fatherhood thing, because this is serious. This is serious. This is not a game. This is a soul we talking about. You know what I mean? This is a life, a breathing life. And so, yeah, that is tough.
Amen. But I've seen you, in your father role from when your daughter was in Head Start, and every, what I liked about you was that every event that she was a part of, I would look into the audience and see you there. Mm. Even once you moved to North Carolina at recitals, graduations, you were there. And she is a wonderful, wonderful young lady that she matured into. I seen you, you know, being a part of one of your children's life and really showing her how a man is supposed to treat a woman with the flowers and just always just being there for her. Like, nobody can't come along and tell her the okie doke and she's gonna fall for it, because she had a real man in her life.
Right.
One more thing. Do you think today's fathers have things harder or easier than you had them?
Nah, it's what you make it. It's what you make of it, you know, because again, even moving, you know, I could have been like, man, because I went through a lot with the mothers of my children a couple of times, and you know, and I could have said, you know what, the heck with this. You know, I don't got to deal with this. I'll just pay child support. But my heart wouldn't let me do that. Plus, the God I served wasn't going to let me cop out like that. And so, because he always reminds me, you know, check yourself, son. Check yourself before you wreck yourself. And because if you harm the very hairs of mine, I was like, oh, all right, Lord, you know, because there were some times where I was like, you know what? I wasn't going to never leave, because see, my dad, He never left us. But the bottom line is, he didn't go through what I went through because of he stayed. You see what I'm saying? That was the difference. He stayed. He dealt with it inside. Most men now, they have to deal with it outside. And when you have to deal with a situation outside, you know how much stuff you can't see that's coming at you? You see what I'm saying? Once you're on the inside of it, you can see, at least you may not be dealing with it the way you really want to, but you are aware of what's happening, because you are close proximity. But if you're not close proximity, anything goes. The mothers can do anything, can say anything, and you're just not there. And that was my problem. I was out. When I left the homes, I ripped something. And that was the disappointment right there, you know. And so I'm still to this day building relationships with my children, even though it's okay, but it's room for improvement. But because I left, that really tore something that I can't blame that on them or the woman. I have to take full responsibility for that. And it has whooped my tail some, but it whooped me in a place where I understand, like, wow, okay, wow, this is what this is the fruit from the root that happened. So I had to uproot myself, replant myself, and then go at it a different way.
Amen. So tell us about your book and what are you doing now, where the audience can reach you.
Right. Well, I have a book called The Millionaire's Brother. You know, I ain't going to tell you the whole story, but I had a brother went to the, you know, I ain't going to even go there. So it's called The Millionaire's Brother. And I wrote the book in 2015. It came to me 2010 when I was in New York. But because I was going through so much turmoil, God didn't allow me to write the book until I reached North Carolina. When I reached North Carolina, somebody actually ghostwrited the book for me. They were so moved by my story. And so the catch to the book is The Millionaire's Brother, you know, but the subtitle of my book, Overcoming the Addictions of Life. That's what's moving right now, especially with the opioids. It's not just drugs, because you can be addicted to anything. Food, you can be addicted to sex, you can be addicted to gambling. So it speaks to that. And so the book is actually, wrote the book and it's on Amazon, you know, but I have my own website, what I tell people, you can go to Amazon, but Amazon's not going to give you an autograph. So I'll send people to my website, www.millionairesbrother.com, www.millionairesbrother.com. And it's a book of testimonies. It's a book of my life. You know, what I've been through as a youth to up until, you know, I went to prison. It talks about all of that stuff. You know what I mean? I was in the streets from 1979 all the way to 1992. That's a long time. And so it was a lot of nefarious things that happened to me, but it's in the book. And so you can catch that on Amazon. Plus, you can go to my website, www.millionairesbrother.com. And the book is doing pretty decent right now. I'm moving around with the book. It's like my book is a car. I get right in my book and drive. You know what I mean? I'm driving my book right now. And so, you know, I self-published. You know what I mean? I didn't have the money for a publicist because I didn't understand what it was. And I was encouraged to self-publish. And that worked out for me because God didn't want the book to go fast for me to blow up. He wanted me to go through a journey with this book because it's a lot of stuff. It's a lot of stuff in this book that you're going to see yourself in this book. If you get this book, you are going to see yourself or see somebody else in your family or somebody that you know. That's how closely you're gonna really see yourself, because I touch on everything that the pitfalls that I went through, you know, and the trick of not. I don't even use Satan. Satan, all Satan does is add on. He doesn't have any power. He has the power of suggestion. He talked to me a lot because I allowed him to talk to me because I was in sin.
Amen.
And that's all through the book. So if you get that book, you're gonna be blessed. You know what I mean?
Amen, amen. So repeat your website once again.
www.millionairesbrother.com, and it's on Amazon. You can go to Amazon, but I encourage you to get the book through www.millionairesbrother.com. And plus, you see my shirt here, Empowered Fathers, got a checklist. You know, I have kingdomwearstore.com. I have a store. A t-shirt store, kingdomwearstore.com. That's where you can get these shirts from. It's available right now, you know, and God, I'm just using this for ministry. This is all tools for ministry. Yeah.
Amen, amen. I've read The Millionaire's Brother, and it's a very, very good book. I advise everyone who is listening to get out and get that book. So what's next for you, Chaplain James?
Well, I'm working on my next book now. You know, I'm in ministry. Because if you get the book, it alludes to the next book. If you get The Millionaire's Brother, it alludes to the next book I'm writing now. So at the end of the day, you know, the next thing is God is pushing me right now. I'm hitting the streets. I'm in the streets. You know, I'm trying to, there's a saying, you know, they call me an unorthodox chaplain. So a lot of people saying they try to make, it's a little inside joke. You know, they say people are trying to get out of prison, but I'm trying to get in, you know? And so, and that's what's happening right now. That's the work I'm doing. I'm doing the work of the Lord. And so I'm excited about it. And cause I'm trying to help these boys become men.
Amen. You know what I mean?
And so that's the catch.
Amen. And can you pray for the men and the fathers right now?
Yes, I can. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you right now for first allowing us to get up this morning. We ask you for forgiveness for any things that we fell short in. Lord, we asking you right now, you said when two or more is in the midst that you are here. I believe you are here on this broadcast. For everybody who's listening, Lord, I pray for the men. I pray for the boys that's in men bodies. I pray for the boys. I pray for the men that, Lord, you said you love men because we are the heads and we are not the tails. And I pray, Lord, that you convict, prick our hearts, prick the men's hearts, touch and deliver and set free, set their minds free, set them free from the captivity that they are in right now in their own mind. Because a lot of them are stuck in their ways and they're stuck in their mind. Just help them to understand that they got purpose. They got work to do. Because before you gave Adam a wife, you gave him responsibility. Help them to understand that they got to be responsible to do anything in this world. And I just ask you to heal their hearts, heal their minds, whatever they're going through, the abuse. Some fathers have been abused. Some boys have been abused, sexually abused, verbally abused, mentally abused. Just, Lord, just help them to, you know, have somebody to touch with them and reach them. Wherever, just pray that somebody gets to these men and they have a epiphany, have something with you, an encounter, so that they can wake up. Because, man, time is running out. Time is running out. And you've given us so much time to get it right. I thank God for Jesus being on the right hand of you, interceding for us. And I'm saying, Lord, just awaken these men, awaken these boys, shake them up as you are doing. And so I appreciate this platform right now. And whoever's under the sound of my voice, men, male counterpart, as well as the women, you know, connect your boys, connect your uncles, connect your cousin, male cousins, connect them, because time is running out. And so we pray right now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you once again for taking your time and coming out on tonight and sharing on Inspirational Moments with Prophetess T. If you have gotten anything from this platform on tonight, don't forget to like, share, and comment. And if you want to get in touch with Chaplain James, he's in North Carolina, but I'm sure he will travel to your venue. He will be virtual to share his mentorship program for boys turning to men. So everyone have a wonderful, wonderful rest of your Wednesday. I will see you on August 30th with another episode of Inspirational Moment with Prophetess T. Good night and God bless.
Good night.
Good night. Thank you.
All right, all right.